call this lake Secret Lake. I'm not going to tell secret anybody lake. Where we are. We're somewhere in Texas, aren't we?
Somewhere
it's a secret
Texas.
Lake.
God's country.
God's country. The couple that fishes together, stays together.
Look at him. Yes, you got it. Yes, sir.
And, oh, Lee, are you okay, Lisa?
Somebody, if she got over,
Lisa,
somebody
Lisa's a good fisherman.
Really? She's, oh, yes, she can fish.
Well, she probably has to be married to you.
Got to use sunscreen.
I'm ready.
Wah! You have to go where the fish are. How beautiful is this place, Lisa? Look at this.
Gorgeous. I think we need to move.
Huh?
Let's go in the shade.
Go in the shade? Lisa, you got to brave the elements, girl. You got to brave them. To catch the giant one, to get to it, you got to go through it.
Thanks, Ed.
Yeah, you got to. Just throw it in the middle there. Let's just let it sit.
Oh. Had a little bite right there.
You had a bite?
Mm-hmm. Oh, I might have a bite.
Set the hook, set the hook, set the hook. Reel down, set it hard. Jerk.
Oh, yay.
Yeah.
Woohoo.
Yeah.
Got Lee. It.
Here, let me get him off the hook for you.
I can get him off.
Yeah. Lee. I started preparing for this trip a couple of days ago.
Did you mention that you may not have slept last night?
I didn't even sleep last night. I'm so excited. Oh, pitiful! That was a... Wah, it was a good bite. Cut your white side leg off. Some of these small ones, I mean, I have to set the hook horrible. That means they're little...
You're talking so loud.
Lisa, I'm excited.
I know, but that scares the fish. You always told me to be quiet in the boat.
I'll put it on that green shag carpet out there. Oh, you cross a lady.
It's all about the frog, honey.
A froggy. There's something about lures like that I like. You know, you can... I'm sorry, Lisa. Sue me, I'm getting excited. Sue me, I'm fishing with my lovely wife, getting excited.
Ed, that's not really appropriate.
And in a place like this, I know you're, you know, we're fishing for, I'm sorry.
Can't be too quiet loud.
We're fishing for a trophy fish because the fish here are absolutely gargantuan. Okay, here's a bite. It's got a bite. It was a good bite. Dadgummit. That's pathetic.
Whoops. What did we say the score was? 1-0?
1-0. We have to find these fish, Lisa. We'll find them. Okay, here's a bite right here.
Yay! There we go. Oh, cute.
That one barely, that's.
Ed, don't say that. He's about the same size as mine.
No, yours is bigger. That's a little dink. Oh, the pressure's on Lee now. The pressure's on Lisa. That's a good cove right there, Lisa.
I got one. Well, we're going down in size. Is it two?
2-1.
2-1?
I know, 2-1.
Hey, Mr. Froggy on the lily pad. What you doing, Mr. Froggy on the lily pad?
Hey, Lisa.
I know, but I taught That's school. Good. That's what you said. Why not just make your own sound effects if you're not catching something?
I got to. If you don't catch one, ribbit, ribbit, ribbit. If you make sound effects when you're fishing a frog, I promise you it's better. God, Lisa, you're tearing me up.
Somebody's got to keep you humble.
Holy.
Are you scared that I'm going to get another one? Got it.
This is kicking my little butt.
Hey, I've caught so many, I've quit keeping score. Ed, help.
Fishing is brutal. Real. Good night. How much what? We're going to go get some luncheon.
I'm hungry.
I am hungry as a bungry. You built this, and so... Fish are coming in here. I mean, obviously it's not on now, Brandon, but these big carp, and we saw a giant. You saw a giant this morning out here.
Oh, yeah. And those that we're seeing right now, those are larger grass carp that are dark, and the bass will be more translucent.
Mm-hmm.
So stripe through the middle of them is the easiest way to identify them. So, matter of fact, that looks like a good bass.
Right, that's a good one. That's a good one. That's a good one.
Yeah, that's a good fish. That's a big one.
That is. He sees it.
Look at that! It's a giant! Get it! It's a monster! He's a monster!
Golly!
Brandon and I were out there. We were looking at fish. And Brandon goes, that's a big bass. And I threw this lure at him and look! That is a monster!
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Lisa, look at this fish.
Yeah, let's see the water.
This is 10.8 and a half.
10.1?
10.13, almost 11.
10.1? 10.18?
That's you have to add a few pounds. You're not a good fisherman if you don't.
Story of our lives.
There's nothing like competition, is there? Especially between a husband and a wife. And yes, I'll admit it, once again, Lisa kicked my butt. She won, she caught more bass than I did. We live in a very competitive culture. I love competition, you know, this is Texas OU weekend. If you're in Miami, Florida State, Miami, all these big NFL games, Friday Night Lights, we love to compete. Competition is a good thing. Whether you're playing cards, whether you're playing tennis, whether you're playing golf, we love competition. We're competitive in the business world. We're competitive in the world of our physiques. We're competitive on social media. It seems that everybody is competitive. Have you ever thought about why? I'm a why guy. Why are we competitive? Why? I truly believe this drive for competition has been given to us by the God of the universe. I really believe that. It's great to be competitive, but I would say, based on scripture, based on studying God's word, the Bible, don't waste your competitive edge. Be competitive. Let's go Rangers. Be competitive. I'm for you, or you're for me. Be competitive, but don't waste your competition. Today, I'm going to talk to you about entering a serious competition, entering a cosmic competition. And that competition is simply this: competing for the souls of people. Competing for the souls of people. Some of you here have been here for this series, this sort of seminar called Hooked. We have been learning that the hook is the gospel. The gospel is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. We discovered the bait, the lure, is Jesus. We discovered that life is a big honking fishing trip. I've taken a lot of fishing trips in my day. Some local, some international. Some have lasted just a few hours. Others have lasted a long, long time. Life is a big fishing trip. The Bible says that God has caught you and me. The Bible says that God fishes for you and me. Just for a second, think about that person that fished for you. Because those of us here who've been caught by the grace of God, we were souls just kind of swimming around. Those of us who've been caught, who've been hooked, someone loved you and me enough to cast to us. Who was that person? Just for a second, assign a name to that person behind the pole or behind the rod and reel or behind the fly rod. Who was that person? Maybe it was a Sunday school teacher back in the day. Maybe it was a parent. Maybe it was a youth leader. Maybe it was a children's pastor. Maybe it was someone you met around the dorm in college. Who was that person that led you to Jesus? For me, it was my father. And I'm thankful for that today as I think about, wow, Dad obviously loves me, but he loved me enough to fish for me. Jesus is the master caster. Say it with me, master caster. That's Jesus. So whenever you have Jesus doing something that's supernatural, you have Satan doing something in the natural. Satan is not the master caster. He's the caster of disaster. In other words, he does not want you and me to get hooked to heaven. He wants to hook us to hell. And we know a lot of people, don't we, who've not been hooked by Jesus. We know a lot of people who've not received the gospel. They're just souls aimlessly swimming around. Well, for us to be competitive, I mean, for us to really understand what competition is all about, I'm going to challenge you, because the scripture challenges me, to get involved in the ultimate fishing contest. I want you and me to jump in, pun intended, and face the ultimate competitor. I want us to face the devil himself. On one hand, he's trying to move people from life to death, yet we're trying to move people by God's power and mercy from death to life. That's the ultimate competition. So don't waste your competitive edge. Don't waste that drive to compete, because I believe God has given it to you and me to really, really compete. And again, don't misread me. I'm all about sports. I'm all about competitiveness. And I'm all about this or that. The main competition, though, needs to be against the devil. Now, when I say that, some are like, wait a minute. Are you saying, because some of you are not believers, are you saying you believe in the devil? Yes. It doesn't take someone with a doctorate in sociology or psychology or human behavior or biology to understand there's a dark, powerful, sinister force wreaking havoc in our world today. How do you explain child pornography? How do you explain tens of millions killed in wars? How do you explain racism? How do you explain genocide? How do you explain the pride, the lust, the envy in your life and mine? How do you explain our government? The corrupt calling the corrupt corrupt, the FBI, the IRS, everywhere you turn, corruption, corruption, corruption. I've never seen as much lying as there is in the world today. How do you explain that? How do you explain that? A damaged chromosome, your diapers were put on too tight, your nursery was painted the wrong color, your mom didn't sing enough nursery rhymes to you. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? The devil. The devil. And Jesus said the devil comes to kill and steal and destroy. He does not want someone, he does not want a soul to be caught by the gospel of Jesus. Yet, as Christians, we have the competitive edge. I'll start the clap. We have the competitive edge. In other words, we have the advantage. Because here's what Jesus said. Jesus said this in a nutshell. If you look at the bookends of his ministry, when he started his ministry publicly, he was 30 years old. And when he ended his public ministry, he ascended to the Father. In those 36 months, he did something. He met one-on-one 132 times with people in the four gospel. One-on-one casting. This is Jesus. So that, should tip you and me off. The church is great. The church is the body of Christ. It's an incredible fishing industry, a tackle store, a fishing center. However, we have the opportunity to fish for people one-on-one. So when Jesus started his ministry, he said, fish! And when he ended his ministry on earth, he said, fish! Fish! F-I-S-H. What does that mean? Look behind me. Focus in our sea of humanity. Say it with me. Focus in our sea of humanity. You have a sea of humanity. I have a sea of humanity in this giant ocean. I'm to fish. I'm to focus on my sea of humanity. In the sea as I'm living. In this life. And that's the Lord's strategy. He hadn't changed his strategy. He didn't say a couple of years ago, I'm going to change. It's not about fishing anymore. It's about something else. No. He said, follow me. We've been studying this in Matthew 4:19. And I'll make you fishers of men. I'll make you into something you're not. you fish for fish. Now I want you to focus in your sea of humanity. You know people, you swim with people that I never will. I swim with people that you never will. Together, what can we do? We can fish. And the beautiful thing about fishing in Scripture, here's what I love, is all Jesus tells me to do and you to do is simply fish. He doesn't say catch. We don't catch. Isn't that cool? The pressure's off. We don't catch. We fish. We cast. We present the lure. We present the bait. He does the catching. So if you want to enter this competition, well, I'm going to tell you some things that should characterize your life. I call these things fisheristics. Fisheristics. Now, if you're not a believer, you're like, whoa, man, this is pretty heavy. This is pretty intense. I mean, fishing, you guys are fishing for me? Yes. And surely you're going to think, man, I matter so much to God that God has talked about fishing for me throughout Scripture. I matter so much to God. Fellowship Church has leveraged huge amounts of people and resources just to catch me. You're right. You're exactly right. So many people talk about discipleship, discipleship, discipleship. You know, the word Christian is only used several times to describe those of us who are Christ followers in the Bible. The words that are used most of the time would be a disciple, a follower. Discipleship begins and ends with evangelism. So discipleship is the sandwich. The bread would be evangelism. So you cannot become a disciple unless, first of all, you're fishing, and discipleship has not really worked. You're still a baby believer if you're not sharing and fishing for souls. I mean, why would Jesus choose fishermen? Have you ever thought about that? He could have chosen attorneys. He could have chosen doctors. He could have chosen pro athletes. He could have chosen teachers. He could have chosen a bunch of preachers. He could have chosen people in the technology industry. He could have chosen actors and actresses. He chose fishermen. Why? They have the competitive edge. Fisheristics, four of them. And ask yourself, do I have these things? Oh, aren't these fish cute? Oh, they're beautiful, aren't they? Goldfish in this fish bowl. This is a nice fish bowl, is it not? With the colored gravel, the fish. I just love to watch fish. It kind of reminds me of the church. A lot of people have this view of the church. Oh, the church is just a fishbowl. Just a few of us. Hi, Daddy will feed you. You just stay in that safe little fishbowl. Everything's going to be okay. This stained glass fortress, that's the church. Okay. So what can happen is we can become so focused on the fishbowl that we turn our backs on the masses. And that's not a pretty picture, is it? Fisheristics. What are some fisheristics? Number one, fishermen. And when I say fishermen, ladies, please, you know I'm talking about fisher women as well. Look, Lisa kicked my tail. I mean, you know. Women really are probably better fishermen than men. You know why? Because women actually listen to instruction. Men, we don't. That's just for starters. Anyway, when I say fishermen, remember, I'm talking about everyone. So no emails, you know, direct messages and all the other stuff on social media. Okay, here we go. Number one, if you're a fisherman, you're real passionate. Look at those disciples. Look at the squad. Look at the tribe. Look at the team that Jesus picked. These bunch of ragtag, foul mouth, wheels off Galileans came from the wrong side, track, blue collar, mean as snakes. They braved the elements and caught all of these fish. They didn't smell that good. They tried to spray cologne to cover the fish smell, but they couldn't do it. A little helpful hint, if you ever have fish smell on you, try some toothpaste to wash your hands. It'll take it off. That's free of charge. They're real passionate. The Bible says in Luke 19:10, the Son of Man came to what? The Son of Man came to do what? Find lost people and save them. We have to find lost people. And the great news today is those lost people, those souls that are swimming aimlessly in your life and mine are in our sea of humanity. We have to become passionate over the things that Jesus was and is passionate about. Why are we here? Not to sin. We're here to help rescue as many people as possible. That's why I'm not zapped up to heaven the moment I become a follower of Christ. If you want to discover what depth is in the Christian life, you begin to get in on this. But it's so comfortable, isn't it? Guys, aren't you having a good time? Just the two of you hanging around in the fish bowl. Everything is fine and dandy. I'll clean the water for you when you mess it up, and I'll feed you the best organic fish food possible. And you know, yeah, I know all these people are facing a forever. I know many are going to hell, but we're just gonna stay in our little fish bowl, aren't we? Jesus says, are you kidding me? You've got the competitive advantage. You've got the edge. You're fishing for me. I'm catching your fishing. Are you passionate about that? And obviously, we've had a lot of people and have a lot of people who are passionate about it. That's why we have so many venues. That's why we leverage so much money and manpower and creativity. Has this service been absolutely stunning? Our video team made that fishing trip just exciting. Do you know how many hours it took just to edit that? I was in on some of it. These guys and girls blow me away. Do you know how the words mean something and how the words support and set up the teaching segment of the message? We do that thinking about the three chairs in the boat. The first chair being those who are going to hell, and we have some who are going to hell. Right now, some of you, if you die right now, would go to hell. I don't want you to go to hell, but you would. You're not a believer. We think about you. We pray about you. You keep us up at night. The second chair would be those who are brand new believers. And many times, brand new believers, you've never, ever got involved yet in fishing, and I want to challenge you and get up in your grill to tell you we are in the fishing business. The third chair in the boat, in this bass boat, you could say, would be those who are mature, those who, by God's grace, cast and cast and cast, and great things have happened because you're leveraging your influence as you kick fin by the faith of the Lord. So real passion. Are you passionate about people knowing Jesus? Are you passionate? When was the last time you shared your faith with someone? And quite frankly, if you're not concerned about the salvation of your neighbor, as a pastor, as a theologian, I'm concerned about yours. When was the last time you shared your faith? When was the last time you tried to share your faith? When was the last time you cast? And when was the last time you actually tried to cast? Great questions. You want to go deep? I mean, we're talking real depth here. This, what I'm talking about, is depth. It's not knowledge. I know a lot of people that go to fishing seminars. I know a lot of people that go to Outdoor World. I know a lot of people that spend a lot of time on fishing websites. I know a lot of people that watch all these YouTube videos. I know a lot of people that watch fishing shows, but they never fish. You've got to fish. Just start fishing. Stop wishing and start fishing. I like that. Number two, we're going to be real passionate. Thank you for your passion. We also need to be real prepared, real prepared. I'm always prepared. I'm always prepared to go fishing. I have like a go bag in my garage. A good friend of mine gave me this little cart. I have all my tackle boxes in there, rod and reels. I'm ready to go. If I can do it, if the lake is full of big, dumb fish, I'm ready to go. Right now. I could be out there soon, very, very soon. I do, though, enjoy preparing for fishing. And when Lisa and I went on this bass fishing adventure, this competition, I prepared. Several days I thought about it, okay? What is gonna best help Lisa really enjoy the day? Now, Lisa's a good fisherman, but it's not like she wants to fish all the time. So I knew she would like the spinning rod. And I rigged the spinning rod up. And I knew there was a worm called the Cinco that's absolutely deadly. Isn't that a great name? Cinco. The Cinco. So I had the Cinco for her, rigged it Texas style, weedless, and I knew she wouldn't get hung up very much, which is great. So I knew that. I also used braided line for Lisa because braided line doesn't have the stretch of monofilament. I thought about that. And I thought about, you know, we're not going to spend all day out there. I knew, because I fished with Lisa before, that we were not going to spend the whole day out there from sunup to sunrise. I would, but she wouldn't. So I knew we had to catch some fish. So I prepared for it. We didn't get up too early. You know, we cruised to this secret lake. We even stopped in a little town and bought some kolaches and, you know, had that fun time and drank some coffee. Normally, I would not have done that, but I did that, you know, to kind of, you know, connect. And that's important, you know, to do that. Think about who you're fishing with. Then we got there, and I wanted to make sure she was comfortable. And we even had a lunch prepared, which I normally don't think through things like that. And so I think you feel me, don't you? You have to prepare. Are you prepared to share? Share your story. You have a unique story. Well, my story's not that spectacular. Yes, it is. Share your story. I was swimming. I was a soul just swimming around aimlessly. Someone cast to me, and by God's grace and power, I was hooked. Jesus is the bait. I was hooked, and now, wow, I'm in heaven, and heaven starts here. And it's not perfect, but heaven is perfect on the other side. And just tell your story. Share your story. Every story is incredible. But here's what a lot of us do. We like to sit. I'm talking to Christians. So many churches I see just sit on the, sitting on the dock of the bay, watching the tide, sing with me, roll away. Ooh, sitting on the dock of the bay, wasting time. Whistle. Excellent. I don't want to fish. You know, I'm already caught. I'm in, you're out. I'm in the fishbowl, you're outside in this dangerous ocean. I'm just going to work on my tan. Oh, this is awesome. The waves. Oh, I love it. Oh. I'm a believer, and I've been caught by Christ. I know people are going to hell around me. They're floundering and flopping around. I'm just going to sit here. Isn't that true? And a fellowship church, we're a church that is comfortably uncomfortable. Say it with me. We're comfortably uncomfortable. We're comforted by Christ, yet we're uncomfortable for Him. Share your story. Pray this prayer. God, as I'm fishing, because everything we do should be about fishing. I mean, we're on a fishing trip. Everything. Everything, every conversation, every situation, every interchange, every exchange should be about fishing, 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 because that's what Jesus did. And I should be passionate about the things He was passionate about, but also I've got to be prepared. The Apostle Paul, read about him. He is different lures in different ways for different fish in different situations. Did you see the fishing contest? Lisa had the plastic worm. I had this big old honking. This bait's called the jackal. It's huge bait because I've discovered something. Big bait, big bass. We constantly change and use things, yet your story is amazing. You began to share your story and you won't believe it. And here's what people do. They go, well, I don't feel it, man. I don't feel the power of God telling me to cast or telling me to fish. I mean, I don't really feel it. God is waiting for you to cast. He's waiting for you to share. Then you'll see and feel the power. Because remember, we're fishing in the supernatural. The devil is fishing in the natural. We're fishing with supernatural bait, with supernatural results. The devil is fishing with natural bait and natural results. People need it. Are you prepared? Just write your story out. Just write it out. You can write it out in 2 or 3 minutes. Here's my life before Christ. Here's how I was cast to and took the hook. Remember the bracelet? And now here's what God has done in my life. That's all you do. You pray, God, give me the opportunity to share it. I promise you, you'll have the opportunity. So be prepared. Be real. I love that real. Get it real. Yeah. Yeah, I love that real. It says in 1 Peter chapter 3:15, always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give you the reason for the hope that you have. I say it this way. High tide, low tide, slack tide, keep on fishing. I've caught fish at all levels of the tide. It doesn't matter. What happens if you don't know enough? I mean, I don't know enough, Ed. I don't know enough. There are many questions I don't know the answers to, but that's why we have brilliant, brilliant, brilliant authors who've written some brilliant books. And I promise you, whoever you're talking to, Mr. Smart Guy or Mr. Smart Girl, is not as smart as some of these authors we have. I know they're not. Some of the most brilliant people I know are believers. Conversely, I know brilliant people who are going to hell. So you can stack up brilliant people who are going to hell and brilliant people who are going to heaven. You just say, okay, check out the evidence. You've read this book or you've seen this movie. Okay, now, here's a book. I have a friend of mine that I'm sharing with. This person is not a Christ follower. He's on his way to hell. I see him regularly. In fact, I work out with him a lot. I've given him several books from our bookstore. And I've challenged him to read the books because he's read these other books. I said, you've not given Christianity a fair shake, man. What if I'm right and you're wrong? If you die, you're gonna be in hell of a lot of trouble, theologically speaking. Yeah, you're right, you're right, you're right. I'm telling you, compelling people, brilliant scientists, brilliant physicians, brilliant attorneys, brilliant atheists who become believers. They're there in our bookstore, in our resource center. That's why they're there. They're in your tackle box. So we've done as much as we can. We've given you the tackle box. I got the tackle box. So just start fishing, please, please. You gotta be real passionate, real prepared. There's another one. You gotta be real persistent. Fishermen are like, fish, we'll get them tomorrow. Yeah, we got skunked, we got bageled, but we'll get them tomorrow. You gotta be persistent and consistent. 2 Timothy 4:5, don't be afraid of suffering for the Lord. You realize that a lot of the disciples had a lot of problems when they started fishing. They didn't catch everyone. Jesus didn't catch everyone because we have a choice. The gospel either repels people or compels people. And I've made casts to fish. I'm thinking to myself, oh, this fish will take it. What? He turned off. Then I'll do another Hail Mary cast. Whoa! Gotta be persistent. You cast, Jesus catches. When I fished, and I'm not a great fisherman. I'm a decent fisherman, but I fish with, number one, great guides, and number two, in great spots. If you fish with great guides in great spots, you will catch great fish. You have a great spot, and you have the greatest guide in the universe. His name is Jesus. We have the competitive edge, the advantage. Don't be intimidated by the devil. He's a liar. Call him what he is. He's the doctor of doubt. He's a cynic. He wants to kill, steal, and destroy. Oh, here's another one, the fourth one, if you're keeping score. Yeah, real passionate. Yeah, real prepared. Yeah, real persistent. Keep on fishing. Real partnership. We get a chance, don't we, to partner, to hold hands, obviously, with Jesus, the ultimate guide. And we partner with the greatest tackle store known to man, the local church. As I mentioned earlier, those of us here who work at Fellowship Church, we work hard. We have an amazing group of volunteers who work very, very hard. Together, we'll partner with you. We will reach this community for Jesus because we want to focus in our sea of humanity. Focus in our sea of humanity. So we'll do whatever it takes without compromise. We'll do whatever it takes as we're under the authority of Scripture to catch fish. Thank you for fishing. If you're not fishing, man, start fishing. And you know what guides say all the time? The guides tell me this, fish it like you find it. Fish it like you find it. Whatever situation you're in, fish it. If it's cloudy, fish it. If it's a bluebird day, fish it. If it's snowing, fish it. If it's raining, fish it. If the water's muddy, fish it. If it's a slack tide, fish it, fish it, fish it. Full moon, new moon, fish it, fish it, fish it. The results will be supernatural. The Bible says in Romans 1:16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel because it's the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes. Just make the cast. You're fishing supernaturally. Make the cast. You're fishing with the power of God. By the power of God, make the cast. Make the cast. Look at our goldfish. Wow. They're having a good day, aren't they? Huh. Just a second. I'll catch one. I got him. Well, a goldfish is dying, flopping, floundering around. Sorry, buddy, you were a couple of dollars, but today is your last day. It's just what, I mean, I don't want to be bad, but the thing's dying. I'll rescue him. Some of you were more worried about that goldfish out of water and dying than you are people in your lives dying without Jesus. All they need is to be rescued. All they need is to be transferred from death to life. Let's fish, Fellowship Church. Let's fish, Fellowship Church. Let's fish, Fellowship Church. Because I don't know about you, but I'm hooked. Are you hooked? Let's fish. 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 Let's pray together. Father, if there's someone here and they've never, ever, ever asked you to come into their lives, I pray that they do so. It's time we stop focusing on the fishbowl and think about those fish that are flapping, that are dying, that are trying to get from their environment to the ultimate environment, which is living for you. And if you want to receive Christ, I'm gonna cast right now. Here's the deal, here's the hook. Jesus loves you. He died on the cross for your sins and rose again. If you just simply say, Jesus, I'm a sinner. I need you. I believe you're my Savior. You lived perfectly, died sacrificially, rose bodily, and right now, I ask you to come into my life. If you prayed that prayer, that's the greatest thing you'll ever do. Other people here in this church, you might be in chair two or three, it's time for you to really get serious about fishing. Think about those people who were flopping and floundering around, those people who were just gasping for breath. It's time that we start fishing. Father, we give this time to you. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen.